Internet routers really have several functions. Recall that IP routing is a connectionless service, so it is performed on a datagram basis, and routing for each datagram is independent of the ones that precede and follow it. We can break the router functions down into the four you see here. There is a forwarding function, which means that is each router receives a packet on an incoming interface. It has to make decisions around which outgoing interface to use to forward the packet on. The second function is delivery. The last router in the chain, the one that is connected to the host machines, that is the destination, delivers the IP datagram not by forwarding, but by resolving the link layer addresses we've seen before. So that's a delivery function as opposed to a forwarding function. The third function is an advertisement. IP routers have routing tables, which we'll see shortly, and those routing tables have lists in them of routes or IP address ranges that are known, and they become known through an advertising process, and that's a function of the particular protocols that are used. The routing update function is how those routing tables get updated, and how the algorithms really choose which outgoing interface are best for a particular incoming packet. In this example, we have a customer edge router. Now that edge router could be at a home, so it could be a gateway like we've discussed before, or it could be a gateway at a large enterprise where there could be hundreds or even thousands of hosts at the premises all going into the internet via gateway. And then we have a provider edge router, which is the peer of the customer edge router. And we have core routers, and then finally we have a content router at the destination. Again, we'll use Google as our destination. In this example, I'm using two fictitious network addresses and one real one. The fictitious networks I've used are the 30.10.10 network and the 20.20 network. In the example, the 30.10 network belongs to the customer, and the 20.20 is a backbone provider that has been contracted by the customer to deliver and receive internet traffic. In this example, I'm going to designate this is router 1, this is router 2, and router 3 in the network 2020.0. So this would be 2020.01, 2020.02, and 2020.03. I've also designated interfaces as interface 2 and interface 3 that direct traffic to those respective routers. When a packet arrives from the customer edge, and in this case, it's this IP datagram traffic packet with that destination address, the source address isn't important in this particular case, then the edge router that receives the packet will consult a routing table. And I've made up a routing table just for illustration purposes here. But when the packet comes in to our number one router, it'll make decisions along the following lines. First, if the incoming packet has an address that is the same or in the network field of the customer edge, then it's going to be discarded because a packet would not be sent back on the same link it was received on. The second test is whether the packet is destined for the router itself. Examples of packets that would be destined for the router from the customer network would be ICMP messages, that is, test messages like ping, for example, and route trace messages and so forth. So those are messages that could be sent to really the local protocol. So let's take as our third case the example where the destination is for the Google content data center. And in the address table, there's a 74.125, and then this entry would cover all addresses within that range. The action to take is forward to the next hop. So IP routing in this example is going to be done on a hop-by-hop basis. That means that our edge router has no knowledge of the total network topology. All it needs to know and understand is the next router that it needs to pass the IP packet to, and that's called hop-by-hop routing. So our next hop, we have two choices. One is our number two router, which is 20.20.0.2, and the other one is the number three router. In the table, since those addresses are indicated, and let's say the router chooses the first entry, the 0.2 destination, it can recursively go back into the cable and find an entry for that destination, and it sees the action is to deliver, not to forward in the strict sense. So it's not going to touch the address in the IP datagram, but it is going to use the next hop IP address to determine the link layer MAC address it would use to actually forward this. It's also going to select the outgoing interface, in this case interface number two. So this means if it were Ethernet, then it would mean that an Ethernet frame is going to be constructed with the MAC address of the number two router and then the IP datagram with the destination 74.125.227.132 is going to be forwarded to that router. In a similar fashion then, the number two router will perform the same lookup that we see, only with its own table. The table at each router is different because of the way the routing updates are performed. Once the packet reaches the final destination, then that router is going to deliver the message, because it's going to deliver it directly to the host machines with that particular address. It's going to do an ARP lookup and find a MAC address or a link layer address similar to this, and then the delivery, of course, would be a direct delivery, not a routed delivery, because you're not using the IP address to deliver the message, you're using the media access control address. Now let's take a look inside the router and better understand how a router is constructed. Some things to note before we leave this is that routers often have choices. I've drawn simplistic diagrams of most of the networks, but we're going to see later that networks are highly redundant. So in a typical case, this edge router would have not just one uplink to the backbone network, but would have two of them, and often there would be two or more edge routers, so you would have double redundancy. And so the routers have to make choices, and there are routing protocols that help with those choices, and we'll look at those not in this session, but in the next session. So if we look at a router, we're going to see that there are three planes in a router. And planes mean functional layers. There is the bearer plane, and that is the plane that carries the traffic. And we saw a bit of that in class number two around how traffic goes from the physical layer up to the IP layer. So that's the bearer train, where user traffic passes. The control plane, we're going to see, is how the routing update is performed. And then the management plane is where craft and operators go to actually manage and engineer the router. So here, if we had traffic coming in on this optical link, we would expect the traffic to come in, go up through the PHY layer and the link layer, and then across the network fabric that is in the router. So I've marked this as having three cards so far. You can imagine a pizza box router or a other kind of router. And we see we have three cards. We have two line cards, one for ingress and one we're going to use for egress. Of course, they're bidirectional, so it would work the other way just as well. And then I've drawn a differentiation between the logical part of the router, which is largely software controlled, and the physical part of the router. So this is the physical part of the router. The next layer we can look at is really the control plane. So this physical layer constitutes the bearer plane, and that's how bearer traffic, like our query to Google, would pass. The control plane is really the plane that determines how the routing is done. In the previous slide, I showed a routing table in routers of scale that are large. That routing table is not centralized, but rather associated with each line card, there's a forwarding information base. The reason is, when you're carrying terabytes of traffic, you can't really scale by having a line card go to a common card and look up something in a database. The database is distributed in this forwarding information base. The control plane is managed centrally by the routing control, which using algorithms is going to populate these forwarding information bases. The final plane is the management plane, and the management plane usually resides on duplex control cards. So these are essentially processors that have control buses, as I've shown here. This is my control bus, goes from here to there. And that control bus extends to all of the functional elements of the router that need to be either configured, measured, or otherwise managed. The control plane has not only configuration responsibilities and what we would call provisioning, that it means building out any necessary parameters, but it also has responsibility for engineering measurements. So as our links start to become more and more congested and they get more and more traffic, we want to know when those links reach their engineered capacity, which might be 60% or 70%, because that tells us we need to add more line cards. So engineering measurements and operational performance statistics are going to be gathered, and those generally are going to go to a set of management systems through a protocol, usually SNMP is the protocol that's used. The other aspect of this, let me just clear this. The other aspect are failures. So inside the router itself, if we have a failure of the fabric, a piece of the fabric fails because it's made of hardware and hardware fails eventually, then the I/O card would issue an alarm over the management bus saying, I've detected a failure. That failure would be forwarded by the control card to a management system. And because these routers are highly duplex, that particular link of failure, that particular fabric failure, would be bypassed through the good through a good link that's on the fabric card. But the fabric card, would need to be replaced, typically during a maintenance window. And we'll talk more about that in the third hour when we talk about reliable systems and how they function. So these are the management functions over here, which I've mentioned already, configuration, performance management, and engineering. Also note that the different line cards can implement different link layers, and you can have quite a range of interface, high speed and low speed cards in the line cards, and they are all designed in a way they use the same network fabric. So once the IP datagrams reach the fabric, then the fabric has no way of knowing one kind of link layer from another. It's just passed across it, and then the appropriate protocol is instituted to deliver it.